So after finishing magnetic effect of current, now I am going to introduce a new chapter termed as electromagnetic induction. In short, you can call it as EMI. So we will come to know in detail about what is electromagnetic induction and why is it termed as electromagnetic induction. So before that, let us understand some concept that is called magnetic flux. This concept is similar to an electric flux. In we have done Gauss's law in electrostatics, we have also calculated electric flux. There we have defined to you an electric flux is the measure of number of magnetic electric lines of force passing through a given surface. Same thing is here exactly. Instead of electric lines of force, now we will basically calculating number of magnetic lines of force passing through a given surface. So what is magnetic flux? It is a measure of number of magnetic lines of force passing through a given surface. So consider a plane of surface area S, which is placed in uniform magnetic field. Normal unit vector on this plane makes an angle theta with the direction of magnetic field. We can choose a small element also, here ds, right? So what is normal unit vector? Plane is here, this my arm is plane. This is the normal unit vector. It is always perpendicular to the surface. Then magnetic flux linked with surface. With the surface. Phi B is equal to Bs cos theta, where theta is an angle between normal unit vector and magnetic field. So you can develop cases, no problem. Case 1, when theta is equal to 0, that is normal is parallel to the magnetic field. It means plane is perpendicular to the magnetic field. In that case, magnetic flux will be maximum and its value will be equal to Bs. Case 2. When theta is equal to 90 degree, that is plane is kept parallel to the field. In this case, magnetic flux linked with the surface is zero. It is minimum, right? Case 3, we can develop SI unit of magnetic flux is Weber, and in CGS system it is Maxwell. and 1 Weber is equal to 10 raised to the power 8 Maxwell. Case 4 also you can talk about right here. If I want to calculate magnetic flux linked with a small element, then magnetic flux linked with an element this will be d phi b is equal to b ds. So total flux phi b is equal to integration of b ds. This will again be a surface integration, like electrostatics. And which law was that? Do you remember? It was Gauss's law. So here also we have a Gauss's law. And Gauss's law here, you can say integration over a closed loop BDS is equal to always zero. However, in electrostatics you have seen Q dot E dot S is equal to Q over epsilon naught. Why is it so that in case of magnetism, Gauss's law value, right hand side value is always zero? This is called Gauss's law of magnetism. And this is called Gauss's law of electrostatics. The reason behind that is, you can easily make it out. In case of electrostatics, charges can be obtained individually. Obtained individually means a positive charge, negative charge can separately be in existence. But in case of magnetism, it never happens that North Pole and South Pole can be separated. Even if you have a bar magnet, you might have heard it even in lower classes, that when we break down bar magnet into small pieces, even each small piece itself is a magnet and it carries North and South Pole both. So monopole does exist in case of electrostatics, monopole does not exist in case of magnetism. That's why if you analogically you can take positive charge is analog of North Pole, negative charge corresponds to South Pole. Now in a loop, in a closed surface, if you keep positive and negative charges both, then what will be the RHS value? Zero. We have done one question, electric dipole is kept inside the surface, then this comes out to be zero. And since here North and South Pole are never separated, so that's why it is also. That's why we can also say that Gauss's law in magnetism justifies that monopole in case of magnetism does not exist.